Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Vincent Xavier, pastor of New Wine Ministries here in the Northwest region of Arkansas. Welcome to our Sunday morning AR1.TV television broadcast. Today we're going to talk about the Nation of Islam and a few other topics that are very important and relevant to our day in which we're living in. By now, this Sunday morning, most of you have already heard or seen the latest video coming from ISIS, a terrorist organization that has dominated the social media in our generation. And we have witnessed the beheading of over 30 young Christian men that have a lineage going all the way back to St. Thomas, the same Thomas that said to the Lord, "Unless I see the holes in your hands and the hole in your side, I will not believe." Well, these recent beheadings and shootings that have taken place on the social media network, on the internet, have been nothing short of brutal. And there is another book that's out there, The Rise of ISIS, written by Jay Sekulow. And Jay Sekulow is the head of the ACLJ. All we know is that this is a very real force. And as Christians living in America, we need to know how to address the issue, because there are two major responses that we have witnessed from individuals that have seen the videos of the brutality of what is happening right now. And number one response is, we need to defend and we need to fight so that these people never come here. We need to go and blow them to smithereens so that they never show up on the shores of America. Well, I'm not so sure that's the best response. Another response is simply fear. People are getting afraid. People are beginning to recognize that ISIS is not just limited to the Middle East, that they are now talking to the nation of the cross, and they are viewing this nation as a grave enemy, as a great enemy, and have established themselves in many ways within this country already, and are bringing the terror, the level of terror, to people's hearts and minds that have been at ease in Zion. So again, the question for you and I today is, how do we respond to this ISIS that is rising, where we have heard Republican senators now saying that all of the components for a dirty bomb or a nuclear weapon have been gathered together by ISIS. They control tremendous amounts of wealth. They are moving swiftly, and they are dedicated in their jihad against the West, against Israel, and against the infidels around the world. How do we, as Americans, and more than that, how do we as Christian Americans prepare for this level of violence? And to help answer some of the questions, I want to go and shift and introduce to you a gentleman who has been a pastor for several years out of Virginia Beach, Virginia, who has been spending much time in Southern California, who recently has been reactivated in the army of God as far as a spiritual warrior with the Word of God, with a creative anointing and an ability to be able to break down spiritual events that are happening in the world today. And I want to introduce Pastor Michael Villarin. Michael, good morning, sir. How are you?
Fine, thank you. Thank you, Pastor.
Yes. It's good to see you, and please introduce yourself to everybody out there in TV land.
I'm Pastor Michael Villarin, and it's true, I've been a pastor in Virginia Beach, and I've just been reactivated by our Heavenly Father, and it feels good to be back on the front lines. You know, Pastor Vincent was talking about ISIS and what kind of movement they're doing, and what I believe the ISIS movement is to create fear in the hearts of people everywhere across this great globe, this earth that we live in. And I think one of the biggest things that we can do as Christians and believers is to stand in a faith like we've never had before. But how to get that faith? Well, we can be Christians for 10, 15, 20, 30 years and say we love Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father, but deep down, do we have earthly fears that we're still hanging on to? I think the Heavenly Father, in this time of preparations, as ISIS is doing its thing, I think our Father is doing something very great in his kingdom, and to his army of believers. Right now, he's preparing an army on this earth, and I believe with all my heart, called the remnant, the overcomers. But what they're doing is that the Father God is, by the Holy Spirit, is revealing any earthly fears that we may have down deep in our soul realm. Now, this is very important because when the earthly fears come upon, we'll call it the fear of man, we should have the fear of the Lord, and there is a difference. The fear of man will bring us into torment and confusion. If we still have any of those type of sins of fear of man in our soul realm, but Father God wants to clean that up in us. But if we have the fear of the Lord, we'll have a peace in the time of trouble. So what he wants to do in his to establish in his believers today, his remnant of overcomers, is to put a peace so we'd be able to stand in this last day. I believe he's raising up an army of overcomers to say this, and I believe this with all my heart, Pastor Vincent, is that we're going to see a group, a remnant of people called by Father God who know they have this calling in their heart to stand in the time of trouble, but also to stand against the last enemy, and that last enemy is death. I believe we're going to hear people, believers, overcomers, standing right in the front and face of death and say, oh, death, where is your sting? Now, if you want to be a company of these people, what you have to do is allow the Holy Spirit really to start moving into your heart. Really dig down deep and say, Father, here I am. Show me these earthly fears. Show me these little foxes that can spoil the vine that I may not be able to stand. If I have fear of a man and fear of the Lord, I'm a double-minded man. And a double-minded man will not expect anything from the Lord. Now, this is just one wave of fear that's coming upon the earth. The ISIS movement. I'm sure there's many, many more. But I think today, people, my brothers, my sisters, the calling of our Father is to prepare ourselves, humble ourselves, get in a place of repentance, humility, showing these things because we want the divine revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ in us so we'll be able to stand. There's many, many keys that the Father wants to show us to be able to be a company of people to stand, Pastor Vincent.
Amen. And, you know, talking about standing, you know, that requires part of the overcoming of the saints of God and overcoming terrorism and overcoming fear. You know, this movement of terrorism is very real right now. It's not just something that's being broadcast out of the imagination of someone's mind. The terrorist movement is very real, and it is coming towards this America, and the saints here seem to be pretty well acclimated to the point where they feel that they never will reach our land. And yet, what do you say to a people that are at ease in Zion, who have enjoyed the life of luxury, who have been bent out of shape over the way somebody looked at them, for example, and have not really understood the level of persecution that other Christians are facing around the world today? What do we say to a people in America today to wake them up from their slumber?
Well, the word I had in my heart, Pastor Vincent, was awake. I was going to tell those who are asleep to awake. And how do you do that? I think you could do it by the voice, by the prophetic, open up your ears, forgive. I think forgiveness is one of the things that could really wake up the heart and the mind. You really got to check your heart to see if there's any unforgiveness, any offenses that you might have carried prior or right now as you're walking as believers, you're holding these grudges or there's resentments. I believe that if you're holding on to any of these things, they will put a sleeping attitude upon you because you're going to get lackadaisical. You're going to get weak. You're going to get sick. And that's not the kind of church that Father God has called us to be. I believe truly that one of the things I can say, for example, is the area of Southern California. Nothing has hit that region as far as weather, catastrophes. The East Coast has been getting slammed by snow, a measured amount of snowfalls, tornadoes in the Midwest. Now, I was out there in Southern California, not even, maybe a little earthquake may have hit, but there's such a sleeping attitude, lackadaisical within the body of Christ out there, like, we're in Southern California, we're all right, nothing has happened to us, and they're living their pleasure of life. But all I have to say to Southern California, to those listening, wake up, smell the rose that's in, you know, of Sharon that's in the wilderness, and wake up, Southern California, because America is going to get slammed, if I may use that word. And it's all it is that it's the judgment by our Father to wake the church up. I think he has to use these waves of fear to get people into a place where they were sleeping to wake up and say, whoa, I am not in a good place. I've got to run closer to the Father. I am not in a good place. And those that do will be smiling and running like a calf out of the stall. But those that hang on to those weighty things of the earth, those earthly fears, I believe when these judgments hit, they're going to grudge, say, oh, I can't forgive, and their heart's going to get hardened. And Father God doesn't want that. I think another reason why all these judgments are going to come upon, like with ISIS, the fear, he wants to wake up the hardened heart. He wants to wake you up and say, look, you're so far away from me. You come to church, you honor me with your lips, but your heart is so far away. See, right now we need to be knitted and close together as the body, as close as we can get. Not just on Sundays and Saturdays, but 24/7. We need to get so much love in our hearts that nothing can touch us. And I think that's one of the keys, Pastor Ben.
So an army of love warriors,
yes,
that are strong in the Lord. It's imperative that people prepare their spirit, soul, and body. But you've been talking about the fear of the Lord.
Yes.
You know, the Word of God says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And what the church really needs right now, what we who are Christians living in this country, in the midst of our politicians, our world leaders, et cetera, we need the divine wisdom of heaven to guide us and direct us. And that begins with the fear of the Lord. And what exactly would you say, Pastor Michael, is the fear of the Lord in truth? What does it mean to really fear God as a born-again, Spirit-filled New Testament believer?
Well, I've come to that conclusion that in my experience as a believer, I believe is the number one commandment. It's, first of all, let me explain this. The fear of the Lord is not to go, oh my gosh, the Lord. No, I believe the fear of the Lord is that one commandment that he says to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's what I believe. And the other one, to love your neighbor as thyself. I think that's the key, truly, to begin to have the fear of the Lord. I think once you have that commandment, and the commandment means authoritative prescription. If you're ailing for something, take an authoritative prescription. That's the best one you can take today. There's two commandments that the Lord gave to us. How simple is that to be in the fear of the Lord? I truly believe, Pastor Vincent, that not only with the love of the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength, but to know this, that you're loved by the Father. I think that's the key to the whole thing. Having an understanding and a directness to saying, I am a son and daughter of the living God. He is my Father. Do you know today, Pastor, that I have found out through my revelation given by the Father that, you know, I thought I was born again at the beginning of my relationship. And what it was, yes, when I accepted Jesus Christ in my heart, I was saved from being condemned along with the world. But I was given, after that, great revelation knowledge, great understanding of the Word, but yet Father God revealed to something in me that I had pride and I had arrogance. And what that was, that's 20 years later after I received the Lord. So I was walking around with great revelation, and I thought I was loving my brother, my sister, my pastor. But my heart really, truly was so far away because I had these hidden fears. And we're getting back to the fear again. I think there's a lot of believers out there thinking they have their right standing with God, but they're not born again. And this is the one of the things I believe why the ISIS movement, why these fear movements, earthly fears are coming upon the earth, because it's going to rattle, or should we say, put an earthquake in your very being, shake you to see, hey, do I really, and ask the question, am I really born again? Well, when you know you're born again, is this, you have to be two things, born of water and born of spirit. Okay, the water is the word as we know it, right? And so when the water washes us and renews our mind and cleanses us, but the most vital thing we had to have is to be born of the spirit. That means the spirit of Christ in us is being raised up by the Holy Spirit working in through us. See, if we're not raising Christ in us, then we're still in our sins. And if we're still in our sins, by the time the ISIS judgment comes upon America, it's going to hit here, folks. What kind of fear will we have? See, Father God, before it hits here, is calling out through the Holy Spirit, through the prophets, wake up, as you said, wake up. And this is the time I really believe that the church as a whole needs to wake up. And I also believe, Pastor, what the Spirit of God is doing is that he's really, really shaking the so-called leaders of churches to wake up, and they're getting exposed because they themselves are finding, man, I'm not really, maybe not born again. There is the question going on. And what the spirit of pride will do is that they'll cover it up. And what they'll do is continue to preach behind the pulpit, but their heart is so far away from the Father, and they're putting this delusion upon the sheep. But Father God sees that, and he's very angry about that. You know, I really believe that with all my heart. Now, I hope I didn't get off track by saying all this.
No, it's okay. You were talking about waking up in Southern California.
Yes.
You know, just recently, a word of knowledge, really, you call it a prophetic word or word of knowledge, that Southern California, that West Coast is going to be shaken by a mighty earthquake.
Yes.
And I truly believe that a mighty earthquake is going to hit West Coast of the United States. And people have been saying it for 100 years, the big one's coming. Now they're telling us, the geologists and the scientists, that we're like 10 months into the pregnancy. We're so far overdue. And it's interesting, right now in the month of May of 2015, a new movie is going to come out called The San Andreas Fault.
Right.
Something concerning a massive earthquake that will strike all the way from the West Coast to the East Coast. And this is a very powerful awakening that would be a favor to a lot of folks. Michael, you're talking about the pastors, the churches that are asleep. And we live in a time right now where there's a lot of separating going on. There's a separation. I'm disturbed by the fact that the Presbyterian denomination has embraced the homosexual agenda. I mean, this has created such an upheaval within the Presbyterian denomination, also in the Episcopal Church and other church denominations, Lutheran churches. There is such an embracing of things that are not correct, and there are people from within those denominations that are leaving, and they're separating themselves from it. So we're in the midst of a great separation. And we knew that years ago, this kind of separation would be coming between individuals, our own hearts, separating the wheat and chaff from within us. And then at this corporate level, there's a great shaking and shifting going on and separating. And in the midst of all of it, there are people who stand out. They're different. And there's something different about them. You know, ISIS stands out right now. They believe that they are fighting a war of faith against blasphemy. They believe that they're fighting against people who are deceived. Their cause, regardless of what anybody says, is, in their mind, a holy war. They are fighting a holy war. They believe that the Christian West, the Jews, have been so deceived, and their deception shows up in the way that they live their lives, and that they are the answer. And one of the things we're going to talk about later on in this broadcast is how God would use ISIS for his own advantage, as he has in time past used the Babylonian nations or the seed of Ishmael to bring judgment to his own people, to awaken them. And so something is happening. Fear is not a good response. Going and blowing them out of the water with all kinds of weapons, they'll come back again. Can't do it. They're here right now. You know, this has been tried before. We've been at war in Iraq. We've been at war with these terrorist organizations. The Christian response, preparing, having oil in your lamp. Let's take some time. I know that you really specialize in the virgins, the wise virgins and the foolish virgins, theologically speaking. What is the necessity right now of people making sure they have oil in their lamps, and what is that oil?
Well, that's a good point. I believe there, you know, as the word says, that there's the foolish virgins and the wise virgins, and they both hear the wake-up call, and both are trimming their lamps. But I think there's a difference in the trimming of the lamps. I believe the foolish virgins are trimming the outside of their appearance, trying to be godly-like on the outside. I think the wise virgins are trimming their lamps, their soul. The inside is being cleansed. And as the inside is being cleansed, then the receiving from the Holy Spirit is being cleansed, is the oil, the revelation knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's called the divine nature. Now, you can't go to someone and say, hey, brother, give me your divine revelation. You can't take it out of them, because it's put inside by only one physician, by one Father. And he's the only one that can do that. because he sees the heart of repentance. The wise virgins are the ones who have a repentant heart, who show humility, who have cleansed themselves to become a bride without spot and wrinkle, and that's their desire. And I believe that with all my heart. That oil, as we know in past wars on the earth, oil has been a high commodity, Pastor. And they fought over the oil over in the Middle East. Just give us your oil. Mm-hmm. Well, the same kind of reaction we're going to get is, but it's going to be by betrayal. Brother is going to hate brother because you got the oil. There's going to be jealousy and enviness. But nothing's going to come nigh thee because we're going to have such love in our hearts. And that's another part of the oil. You know, there's such overcoming love. And you have to have this love to overcome what's coming upon the earth. I believe also, too, Pastor, says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And those that have a pure heart shall see the Father in the Beatitudes. And I really believe the oil right now is the most precious commodity one could have. Now, there are Christians who are taking their oil and going and taking it back to the world. They're going in there and they're fornicating with idols and with demons. And their oil is being sapped out of them. You know what I call those kind of demons, those kind of personalities? Anointing suckers. That's what they're designed to do, is to zap the oil out of the believers, the wise virgins. But it can't happen unless you're alert, you're awake, and you're preparing yourself, and you know what time of day it is. And I believe that's really important.
Yeah, absolutely it is. Michael, earlier on in the broadcast, you mentioned that there would be a people that would rise up in the last days, and they would overcome the last enemy to be destroyed. Is death.
Yes.
And that's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. What's interesting, in Revelation chapter 6 and verse 7, it talks about the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And the fourth horse is said to be a horse that is pale in color. It's kind of greenish in color, is the real Greek. And the name of the one that sat on this pale horse is death. His name is death, and hell followed him. And power was given unto them, hell and death, over the fourth part of the earth to kill with the sword and with hunger and death and with the beasts of the earth. I find it very interesting that the very next seal is about those who have been martyred for their faith in Jesus Christ. The fifth seal is about the martyrs under the altar. And so here you have in the last days a horse that is riding, and the rider's name is death. Jesus said, or Paul the Apostle, by the Spirit of Christ, said in 1 Corinthians 15, that the last enemy to be destroyed is death. And I wonder if, because we are in the last days and we are the final generation before the second coming of Yeshua, the Lord Jesus Christ, if the overcoming of this last enemy, death, is what we're facing right now.
Yes.
And the perfect love casts out all fear. That's in 1 John chapter 5.
Yes, sir.
So perfect love casts out all fear. How would you say to a generation of people that are called to be overcomers, to enjoin themselves to the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, to overcome the last enemy, to destroy the last enemy, death, how do we do that spiritually speaking?
Well, how do we do that spiritually speaking? I believe that we have to have, first of all, is that you have to have the revelation knowledge that you've been called and chosen for a time like this. That's what I believe. You've got to know that you know that you know what your mandate is. I know what my mandate is for this time of day, the predestined time that we're living in. Father God has to have a witness so his word is true, that there is an overcoming people who are going to face death. And the only way that you're going to know is that you have to know. You have to know by the Holy Spirit, by Father God telling you personally, this is what you've been called to do. This is what you are called to do. If it's that one thing in all your years, be it 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old, if you know that you're supposed to stand and say, death, where is your sting? Then you better listen. Because it is a special time for that calling to start coming about. It's going to come about. You're going to see people because the witness has to be true that his word is true here on the earth, that there is a company of people. It has to come about. And the spiritual preparation is just that, the faith. It's all by faith. And faith comes by hearing the word and the word of God and in the personal revelation.
Amen. It's been a wonderful time just talking with you, Pastor Michael, as you're getting prepared to go on the journey that is before you. And we really honestly need to continue the discussion about what is happening, because Christians oftentimes have a tendency to block out reality by quoting scriptures. And they cover themselves with scriptures, but the Bible doesn't say that you're hidden because you quote scriptures. The Bible says we're hidden when we dwell in the secret place of the Most High and abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I know that as we continue the dialogue, we're going to be confronted at some point with the reality that we are dealing with a force that is on this earth that is hunting and seeking the Christian and Jewish community for the overthrow and destruction of them. And we're witnessing that they're real. However, there is a victorious, overcoming, more than conquering, triumphant people that will have the victory in this battle, who will not entertain a moment of fear. But Pastor Michael, at the same time, there's a weeping, there's a sadness, and yet that too must be set aside, knowing that those who are being killed for their faith will be the first in the resurrection to rise. And they will be seated in heavenly places on thrones, ruling and reigning in the millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ. I believe it's time for the message that you possess to go forward to the nations, to wake the people, disciple the nations once again, beginning in the house of God, prepare and equip a people for spiritual warfare and a spiritual battle with these end-time forces that are rising. We believe in spiritual warfare, don't we?
Yes, we do, Pastor.
I mean, without it, what do we have?
We are nothing. We have nothing.
What are we going to use?
What, a gun?
I mean, it'll work for a moment, right? It might get us out of some trouble, but there's got to be a more superior power than a gun or a weapon. Nothing wrong with guns. Nothing wrong with having one. It's a constitutional right. Every American ought to have one,
right,
quite frankly. But it's not the answer or the hope or the trust of God's children, these overcomers that are going to rule and reign with a rod of iron. A final word. We've got about a minute before we have to go to the break.
I would just like to say to my brothers and sisters out there, don't concentrate and watch the television programs 24/7 about the ISIS. Put your spiritual eyes and spiritual ears on our Lord Jesus Christ and our Father, and the revelation knowledge of Him in you. That'll give you a great peace. And I just want to say, Pastor Vincent, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
For having me here. It's been a pleasure. It's been a great, great conversation. And I want to say I love you.
Yeah, appreciate it, Michael. God bless you. I love you too. And this man will be moving out into the nations very soon with a message. God has a bunch of people that have been hidden in the caves of Adullam or have been in the prisons with Joseph that he's about to bring forth, that are not trained out of our schools of theology, but have been trained in the classroom of Christ Himself. They've gone through something. They've been through very difficult times, hard times. And I believe it's a people like this. I believe it's the Davids that have been in the wilderness. It's the Josephs who have been betrayed by their brothers. I believe that there are a whole host of men and women that have been out in the wilderness, hidden from the view of the eyes of this world, that Father God is now bringing forth as He has had borne a testimony within them. Maybe you're one of them. If you are, I want you to stay tuned. When I get back, I'm going to be interviewing a gentleman and now is operating in some knowledge about end time events that we're going to talk about in just a moment. Until then, this is Pastor Vince Michael Viller, and God bless you, sir.
Thank you.
We'll talk to you real soon, and we'll be right back.
Thank you, Pastor.
Hi, once again, I'm Vincent Xavier. I'm so glad you've been tuning into these AR1.TV television broadcasts. I'm so glad that you are. And one of the ways that you can let us know that we're a benefit and a blessing to you is by contacting me personally at my email address, vxavier777@gmail.com, or you could send a gift to the ministry to P.O. Box 100, Decatur, Arkansas, 72722. And what you're doing is letting us know that our message and our ministry and our work is beneficial to you. We would love for you to partner with us to support this ministry because we intend to go all over the world. I am so thankful that Curtis Coleman and Tammy Griever have allowed us to bring this message into their television ministry. AR1.TV is a ministry that's worthy to be supported, and I hope you do, and I hope you support New Wine Ministries. Until we meet again, this is Pastor Vince. Goodbye. Welcome back to the broadcast. I'm Vincent Xavier. The next 30 minutes is going to be an action-packed time as we spend moments with Daryl Wagner, who is a gentleman who has been preparing for the last days for quite some time, who has taken a very sober, responsible approach to the days that we are living in and the times that we are facing as a nation, and has allowed himself to prepare his skill for the well-being of people that will be near to him in the days that lie ahead. We are a generation right now that is facing a tremendous amount of activity against us, there's no doubt. Our purpose for being on the air today and always is to prepare and equip a people for the days that lie ahead. Earlier in our interview, I interviewed Pastor Michael Villarin on the necessity of preparing spiritually. And now I want to talk with Brother Daryl Wagner on the necessity of preparing physically. And because he has actually spent time in doing so, I think he has great information for us. So help me welcome to the broadcast, Daryl Wagner. Daryl, welcome. God bless you. Welcome. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing pretty good, Pastor. How about yourself?
I'm doing very well. Thank you. Michael was talking to us about the necessity of spiritual preparation. What are the necessities for our practical, everyday, natural life, physical life preparations for the days that we live in?
Well, there's five things, starting with zero. Zero is that you had to be spiritually prepared. You had to have a good spiritual foundation. Studies have shown that soldiers who have spiritual belief systems fare much better than those that do not.
Interesting.
So during any type of crisis situation, if you have a good spiritual foundation, and being a Christian, you know, my Christian or my spiritual foundation is within Christ, I believe I'm very well spiritually prepared. I also believe that, so that's zero. You know, that's even above the first thing, you know, that you had to be spiritually prepared. And the next thing is obviously you have to have a supply of fresh water. You know, you will only last a few days without fresh water. Next to that is food, obviously, shelter, security. And security is very important, but it's not something that you should go overboard on. Okay. There is lots of, quote, survivalists that will get AR-15s with night vision scopes and you name it, and they have it. They spend thousands and thousands of dollars on these weapons. And I don't think that we're really going to need that type of firepower, you know, if you prepare in advance. But you will need some. You know, I'm not saying don't get an AR-15. I have an AK-47. So, you know, having a good set of tools is very important for security. The fifth one, which is, you know, all these that you need, if you don't have one of them, it's going to kill you. So the fifth one is communications. Most people cannot go a whole weekend without picking up their cell phone, turning on their television set, or turning on the radio, jumping on the internet. You know, we're addicted to instant communications. If we have a grid down situation, whether it's from a tornado or from a hurricane or from an EMP attack or a solar flare or a plague, you're going to lose communications if you don't have prepared for it. Personally, I have solar cells, panels that can generate enough power to power my amateur radio, often called ham radio, enough to take care of light and other things that, you know, would be nice to have. I didn't go totally overboard. You know, I don't power my whole house on solar, but I have enough solar to get me through any grid down situation for a very long time. I don't know, you know, I don't want to find out how long that is, but, you know, hopefully I can go for years, if not more, with the amount of solar I have. But communication is drastically important. You know, if you're cut off from everything in the world, you have no income of information, then what are you going to do? First thing, it's going to be depressing. You know, you're out at your little hideaway, and you're not hearing any news. You don't dare go out because somebody might, you know, cock you over the head and rob you for what you have. So you're stuck in, you know, almost a prison that of your own making. And if you don't have any knowledge of what's going on around the world, then you're kind of hosed. Now, the other important thing besides those things is there's going to be a few lone wolf survivors, but they're going to have more luck than anything else. The way that you're going to survive any type of disaster is through a well-grounded, trusting community. I think this should be a spiritual Christian community where like-minded, trusted people are going together so that they can basically watch each other's backs.
It's a very grave scenario that's being presented, but it's important that we see that. It's important that our viewers understand that there have been movies, there have been books, there have been documentaries that have presented the idea of a lights-out scenario, that there is the potential from Homeland Security, from CIA, from FBI, from different agencies concerning a total collapse of our society here in the United States, particularly that electromagnetic pulse or several detonations of nuclear weapons that would send our nation into absolute and complete turmoil. And so seeing that we face these very real threats, it is so important that men and women, particularly Christians in the United States of America, begin to look at these threats as soberly as Christ presented them to the disciples 2,000 years ago when he told them, when you see certain things, you need to flee into the wilderness. You need to flee into the mountains. Unfortunately, Daryl, we have a generation today that has been saturated and downloaded with an idea of a doctrine called the pre-tribulational rapture doctrine that basically precludes that we're not going to be here when bad times come. And a lot of people are struggling with that idea now as we're witnessing our brothers and sisters in different countries that are being beheaded and they're not just disappearing. And so we have an unprepared generation for the realities that are coming. And unfortunately, that's going to lead to a terrible time of apostasy because people are not going to be able to handle the levels of violence. And you mentioned that we need to be community-oriented and we need to be outside of the city, so to speak. Our Lord Jesus Christ said that we do not want to get caught in the snare. He said, like a snare shall it come upon the whole world. And definitely being in an inner city of sorts is going to be likened unto being in a snare. Quickly, I'm reminded of the story in the days of Elisha the prophet in a city called Samaria, where there was a great famine in that land. And while there were so many different dynamics to the story, one of the main parts of the story is about these two women who made a deal. And one woman said to the other, okay, today we'll eat my son, and tomorrow we'll eat your son. And one day the king of Samaria is walking along the wall as the people are in such dire straits. They're buying a donkey's head for 2 pounds of silver. And they're buying dove's dung for 2 ounces of silver. That's how impoverished and that's how bad the famine was. And so these women made the deal, and the king's walking along the wall, and the woman shouts out, oh, king, help me. And he said, if God can't help you, how can I help you? It was just desperate. And then he asked her the question, what's the problem? And she told him, we made a deal to eat my son yesterday and her son today, and we ate my son, but then she hid her son. Daryl, the point of the story is that when famine hits and people are not ready, insane things are going to happen to people. It is important that we recognize the signs of the times and then do what Jesus said to do, flee those inner cities. And by doing so, you have to have a prepared place, and that's pretty much what you're advocating. So please continue on in telling the viewers how real these times are. How close are we to different events that could possibly bring us back to the 18th century?
Well, we are 3 days away from the solar flare that could do that.
Okay.
If you are a believer in the pre-trib, which I am not, then it may not be the tribulation that gets you. We may have hard times that isn't directly related to the tribulation. Mm-hmm. You know, like a hurricane, like a tornado, like a solar flare. Mm-hmm. If a solar flare hits, we have between 48 and 72 hours to prepare. Mm-hmm. And don't say that's never happened here. In 1859, there was a event called the Carrington event. The solar flare was so powerful, it set telegraph wires on fire. It set telegraph offices on fire. And the thing to remember about telegraph installations back in 1859 is they was drastically over-engineered. They probably had 4 or maybe 8-gauge cable wires, which are very thick. I can carry a lot of current. We don't have those type of wires today. You know, we use extremely high voltage to carry a lot of current through. And the government and the power companies have not protected us from a solar flare. And more recently, there was an incident up in Canada. I don't remember what year it was. I think it was around in the 1990s, and it knocked out Quebec for a couple of days. And in 2004, I think it was in November, we had a shot across the bow that if that had hit, we wouldn't be having this conversation today. Mm-hmm. It was so powerful that it saturated these satellite sensors that picked it up. They're estimating it was between an X-40 and an X-50 flare.
Wow.
And we believe that probably a X-30 flare will take out the grid. It may be more than that, maybe less than that, but you know, hopefully we don't find out in our generation. I'm being selfish on that, but that's something I really don't want to go through. So if that happens, within, I would say, 30 days, worldwide, we'll have probably 500 million people dead. And within, you know, 6 months, we're probably going to be really close to that 500 million population that the Georgia Guidestones talks about as what the Earth should have. So the people that are going to fare best are the low-technology countries, because they're used to living without mm-hmm. technology, where, you know, we can't go 15 minutes without checking to see who texts us.
Unfortunately, the third world countries that depend upon our charities and they depend upon the goodwill of other nations to send them their food supplies, whatever food supplies they get, everything stops at this point. I mean, there's no communication. There's no transportation. We find in Katrina, you mentioned about a massive hurricane. Katrina absolutely showed the potential of what would happen, not only in the here and now, but what would happen around the world, where people would be in a state of absolute chaos and confusion. Unless, of course, you live in Japan and you have a 9.0 earthquake, everybody seemed to be pretty mellow in Japan. There was like an order to things, and they didn't get into the chaos and confusion. But unfortunately, there's a lot of radiation poisoning from that massive 9.0 earthquake. We foresee earthquakes. We foresee the Yellowstone events that you've talked about in times past. I'd like you to bring that up right now, if you wouldn't mind. And we foresee other events that could really do a lot of damage to our country and to our nation.
Yes, indeed. When I talk to people about preparing and being prepared, you know, I go through the list of possible disasters that could bring down the grid, because as long as the grid is up and running, we're going to get by. Mm-hmm. But if that grid ever goes down for more than a few hours, we're in a world of hurt. So the top of my list is solar flares. They estimate that there's a 20% chance in the next, I'm sorry, it's a 12% chance in the next decade of that happening. And that's to me, that's an unacceptably high risk.
12%.
Yeah, 12%.
And that's just from a solar flare coming directly from the sun. But there are other means of an EMP.
Correct. A high-altitude nuclear explosion will cause a different type of EMP. In some ways, it's even worse, because it will fry the electronics in our computers and cell phones and radios and you name it. I have what they call a Faraday cage, that I have a ham radio and some other small radios in, so that if there is a EMP, I will still have some type of communications. The advantage of having a nuclear EMP is it's localized. So if one goes up, or the most efficient use of an EMP would be on the East Coast and the West Coast. So if they only was going to set off two, that's where they would probably set it off. You know, they would get the biggest bang for their buck. However, so the central United States might, you know, survive that without too much problem. Other countries will not even know it, you know, as far as being affected by it, except that the United States, as we know it, has ceased to exist. So there will be an opportunity to survive where a solar flare will burn out these large transformers, and they will, you know, be gone, and will be gone for years, if not decades, because there's only a couple countries that actually produce them, and I think they have already, right now, they have a 12 to 24 month backlog or back order on those. So they're not producing a lot of them, and they don't have the facilities to produce them. That is if they can get the power to produce them. So trying to bootstrap getting the grid back in operation is going to be a very tricky operation if there's a solar flare.
Now, you said that there were five things that were so necessary. You counted from zero, the spiritual preparation. Mm-hmm. Then you said water, mm-hmm. food, shelter, security, and communications. And all of that should be within the context of a community of like-minded believers, ultimately a Christian philosophy, a Christian belief system where the love of Christ and the Holy Spirit is activated within the hearts of those individuals. And their relationships have been tested. They've been proven through perhaps months, years of experience together, how they treat one another, et cetera, in the times of minor crises. Because these end times that we're talking about have the potential to really squeeze at our innermost being all the different things that lay dormant within us. Earlier in the broadcast, as Pastor Michael was talking with us, he was talking about the inner fears of man. He was talking about the little foxes that spoil the vine, the things within us that will ultimately rise to the top, so to speak, when the crises get strong enough or when the pressure gets strong enough. And so we have to be in trusted communities, but they are necessary. They are necessary because therein you have individuals that have honed their skills, that have proven themselves to be trustworthy and faithful to their in their friendships and in their dealings with one another, and people that can assist and help make life a little bit easier outside of the snare and be able to survive for a period of time, 3.5 to 5 years. This is important. How many people do you think at this point, Daryl, are really prepared for a solar flare or an EMP or a Yellowstone event or a massive earthquake or some other event that will bring us back into the dark ages?
I would say in our country, if there's 10,000.
If there's 10,000.
I would be surprised.
And the rest of the people are dependent upon the government? What are they depending on? The preacher of rapture and all these different things.
The Christian, or most of the Christians are probably dependent on the preacher of rapture. The secular people are going to be dependent on the government, which will not be there at all. We just don't have the resources to handle anything that widespread. You know, if it's more than a statewide disaster, then, you know, most of these people are going to be taking care of their own families, and I don't blame them. I would be too. You know, the Red Cross, you know, the HAMS that helps out at Katrina and Joplin and 9/11, you know, the first thing they tell us is take care of your own family first and then come and help others.
Amen.
And the government workers are going to be the same way, and everyone's going to be in the same boat. This is going to be a non-discriminating event. If there is a grid down situation, and the other things that can cause a grid down situation is a financial collapse. You know, if the electrical workers aren't getting paid, they're not going to come to work. You know, they probably will for a while, but at some point, you know, they're going to have to start taking care of their own family. During any collapse like this, there's going to be plague. You know, we're so used to our wonderful sanitation system that cholera and typhoid and all those other diseases that we only read about in our history books are going to come back and visit us with a vengeance. So it's going to be really important to, you know, really have a plan and get in touch with the Holy Ghost to develop that plan your own personal plan. We all need a relationship with Jesus Christ, and Jesus will help us develop the plan that is right for us. You know, the plan that is right for me isn't the plan that's right for you, isn't the plan that's right for Pastor Michael, you know, or Joe down the street. So we need to be led by the Holy Spirit to develop that plan that we can survive and do God's work once this collapse has happened. Mm.
You know, we're down to the last couple of minutes in our broadcast. These thoughts and ideas that we're hearing today, we're talking about preparation. We always look through the biblical lens at the signs of the times, and there are people all over this country, obviously, that have been thinking this way. This is not just some imagination that is developed out of someone's thinking and to put into a script and write a movie about. These are very real events, and they are happening all around us. Our nation is in more of a critical time frame right now, Brother Darrell, than probably any other time in its history. We have some pretty evil legislation that's coming down the pike right now, and I believe the level of wickedness that's being developed and conjured up in our nation, God forbid this solar flare or this nuclear meltdown or this financial collapse creates a society of hostility, we're going to see some pretty evil things happen. And the most important thing is that people get outside of the traps. And it is so important to be able to discern the moment of when to go. Folks, I believe that we're years behind schedule if you have not yet moved out. That if you have not prepared those essential things, your heart with God, if you have not gotten yourself your water supply, a food supply, shelter, and security, and communications, and in a corporate setting, if you have not begun to move in that direction, you are years behind schedule. Some of us have been preparing for quite some time, and I'm so glad we did. We prepared by the leading of the Holy Spirit, and then we've learned to live an abundant life as we go. But right now, we're concerned about the multiplied millions of people who have refused to prepare, who have really turned a deaf ear and a deaf blind eye to what's happening in our society. Darrell, I want to thank you for joining me and sharing your thoughts. I mean, a lot of people are thinking, gosh, that's kind of direct, but it needs to be direct. It's that kind of time that we're in right now, is it not?
Yes, it is. And, you know, the other thing that probably really needs to be said is that, you know, think about what you will do when something happens. Don't wait until something happens to think about it, because people get into a mode of deer in the headlights and they will wait too long before they do something.
Amen. It's a great point. Oh, folks, we are living in the most amazing days, and I'm laughing because the intensity of this moment, if you don't allow yourself a little bit of restraint and just rejoicing in a resurrected Messiah, you could get in a lot of trouble. But on a serious note, the things that we're talking about are real, and we need to be prepared. I hope that this broadcast has been a blessing to you to help you to do so. Until we meet again, God bless you.